Conservation Commission meeting, and tonight's meeting is being recorded for RCTV. It's live, and you can view it at Comcast Channel 22 or Verizon Channel 33, and you can check www.rctv.org for more information and for replay times. We have, one of our members will be about 15 minutes late, Mr. Michael Flynn, and he does want to be present for the town's dewatering plan on West Street. So if I could kindly have you postpone that to the time when he comes in. And we're going to go right to old new business and discuss the certificate of compliance at 270-0535 RGB 2008-2934 Pond Lane, map 45, lot 36. Mr. Toomey?
Yes.
Yes. We had a site visit. I think we went out Monday around 2 o'clock. Nobody was home. We observed in the back of the property, the back side of the house, it's very flat, and you have a soccer net up there in that location.
Across,
right. And but we did notice that a little bit beyond that, between the flat area and the wetland 25-foot bounds, that mm-hmm. we did observe that there was actually like a 2-foot drop, and there was some erosion, mm-hmm. signs of erosion going on there.
Yep.
And we just couldn't tell from the plan if it was supposed to be flat or if it was supposed to be graded down. Do you have any recollection?
So when they graded it, I think part of the challenge was there was some ledge all over the property, so they graded it the best they could for that piece of the property. You might have seen the original plans. There was supposed to be another almost 1,100 square foot pool back there with a deck.
I never saw the original plans.
Yeah. So that was the original plan, and then we decided to pass on the pool. So it's been graded the same way it's been the entire time. I had a respray for grass once. It's at the tail end of the season right now. My son plays lacrosse, so he practices lacrosse back there with a bunch of his friends. So the grass is in the best shape, I think, right now. It's come back over the years because I did have it sprayed during the period of time. So I don't know if there's suggestions for me keeping that.
We're talking about Pond View.
All right. Sorry I'm late, everyone.
You weren't that late?
Yeah.
Got a couple minutes, that's it. That was good. Good timing. So I did explain to Mr. Toomey that we observed some erosion in that, like, 2-foot drop.
Yes, yep.
Right, yeah. He described that there was a lot of ledge back there.
Okay.
That, I don't know what they did when they graded it.
All right. And then we also did observe some yard waste in the back.
Oh, that's right, yeah. Sort of in the middle?
Yeah, I guess so.
Middle
I thought it was
to the
more
right.
towards the right side.
Yeah. So if you could remove that, there's some pretty fresh grass clippings mm-hmm. and leaves back there. There, the bound is right here, and then it's further into towards the wetland.
Into the wetlands?
Yeah.
Okay.
Do you have a lawn guy, or do you do it yourself?
No, I have a lawn guy.
Yeah, you got to tell him that he can't.
Yeah, they blow it out to the street. So they go in 3 feet and then take all the stuff out so it doesn't leak down in there.
Yeah, well, somebody's piling it up back there. So
It wasn't a huge pile.
Just a little pile?
Yeah.
It didn't look like it's something that's been happening for a lot of times. You see this, you can tell it's something that's been happening for years and years.
Yeah, no, because I tell them you can't blow it into the wetlands. You got to blow it out. I'm happy to take any suggestions for the area there, if you have any.
Can you give me some idea of just, like, square footage area of erosion?
Probably, what,
2 feet?
10 feet of lawn, the back 10 feet of the backyard?
Yeah, the 10-foot strip, you mean?
No, it's longer than that.
Well, 10-foot strip going down the whole the length, I guess, is the zone.
The length of the property line of the back lot.
Yeah.
Okay, so it's just a,
and it's
like
just,
a
it
one
slopes
to two
off
foot.
Really steeply,
yeah.
And it's just hard to get the grass to grow because it's a little bit shady, and it's
could recommend some kind of low-growing bushes back on that slope to use the root system to kind of stabilize that erosion.
Are we talking about, so it's a 10-foot long, roughly stretch, about three to 4 feet wide, or?
No, it's
By 75 feet along the back of the.
Oh, it's the whole back.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's the whole
yeah.
back.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wasn't sure if we were talking about small or big. Okay. What's growing there?
Nothing. Grass.
Nothing.
What? So grass grows back there?
Yeah. So part of the other problem too is I don't have it sprinklered all the way to the wetlands because I thought that was probably inappropriate. So
depends
I have sprinklers that are 15 feet out that go circular around. So it probably just catches the end of the area that's into the wetlands.
Is it a shaded area?
It is shaded. Mm-hmm. There's tons of trees that came down, and there's tons of acorns everywhere, which is probably the pile of whatever you saw back there is the acorns.
So some sort of vegetation in that area that could, so what the vegetation does, the roots of whatever you plant out there, as you could probably guess, it grabs hold of that soil,
mm-hmm.
and it stabilizes it. And it'll prevent, so more plant growth in that area will reduce erosion
mm-hmm.
in that strip. So, sometimes I personally hesitate to recommend a specific plant because so that you can have the flexibility to fit what you would like to see, whether it's a variety of grasses or what we call herbaceous growth, so just low, like field type grasses and plants, or we could talk about shrubs, which start to take over, and there you could do fewer of those at a bigger spacing, but usually something to sort of stabilize and.
Yeah, my problem is I think I'd have 75 feet of shrubs across the back of my yard, 10 to 15 feet from the where the boundary is. I've already given up 23,000 square feet in the back of my yard.
Now, wait a minute. The boundary, is that the wetland line itself?
Yeah.
Well, there is a buffer zone that's protected under the town regulations.
25 feet. That's
it's
what
it's a 25-foot
the bounds.
Zone of natural vegetation that we have jurisdiction over. That's
sure.
25 feet from that. So if that's part of what we're talking about, we can respectfully ask that a couple of plantings get put, or at least the that you take some measure to support vegetative growth back there.
Okay.
But that's what we're here to discuss.
Okay.
So.
So I apologize if I'm rehashing things. Has grass ever grown back there? Has it grass ever been able to grow on that slope there?
On the side of the hill.
Yeah.
It has.
Mm-hmm.
But it's been difficult to keep. And again, it's been more difficult to keep because that part, the way the sun comes is around the side, so there's a very narrow strip if it's any sun.
Right, so there are some shade-tolerant plants.
So the only thing with bushes, like, to me, it just seems like that's not fixing the problem. We're putting something else in between that and the wetlands. It's still, we're still not talking about a solution on that slope, on the hump. Is that where you're talking about putting the bushes? Right on that?
Right, on the slope. I mean, the root system would actually stabilize it if you had something like low bush blueberries. Not a lot of them, but a few.
It seems like an odd spot for like a long row of bushes like that. I mean, Al, I don't know, could you speak to ways that you could try to have the grass grow there?
I apologize because I missed the site visit. But I'm not sure. I think what he's trying to accomplish is to get lawn so he can practice, his son can practice.
Yeah, I'd be putting
as far as
you
can
son.
Down to the 25-foot bound. Is that?
Yeah.
I mean, I think the way to do that is just with the sun shade mix and just fertilization and see if he can get the grass to stabilize up to the 25. Now, inside the 25, is it eroding inside the 25?
No, it's
outside the 25.
It's just
yeah,
grass.
It's outside.
Yeah, it's outside
it's
the 25. Yeah, I would make an attempt at. I talk to a good landscaper and get a good sunshade mix, conservation mix, and see if you can stabilize it with lawn.
Okay.
The other thing is, we're not going to give you. We shouldn't be giving you a lot of advice on how landscaping.
Sure, I understand.
But what you may find too is that what was put down what's under the grass seed there may not be the ideal growing conditions for a lawn. So it may have just been spread real thin and not great material, not enough organic matter in it to help the grass grow. We don't want you pouring a bunch of fertilizer on it and running that
well,
into
can,
it.
You can get some environmentally safe fertilizer.
Yeah. So I agree. I get, you know, it's done according to the as-built plan.
Mm-hmm.
Get some grass to grow.
Okay.
Just some shade mix.
So are we entertaining issuing an order of conditions?
Can I just ask a question? Why wasn't issue ordered previously? This is a completion.
Sure. If I may, so I had I asked for a 3-year extension to consider whether we build the pool or not. So I asked the order of conditions to be kept open,
right,
and then we decided not to make the pool.
All right, thank you.
Yeah, sure.
Do that because of the ledge?
No, my kids were getting too old and
too old. Okay.
I thought
it might have been too much ledge. So this is a certificate of compliance that we're talking
about.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right. I'm tempted. Is there a rush on? Is there a specific reason why you're requesting this?
It's holding up some financing for me because they've asked for this order of condition to be closed.
Okay. Is the erosion significant enough to warrant an additional site visit after plantings or after some?
I'm happy to try to put some more grass down or talk
about. Yeah, but this is not the season for that it's going to take. So.
Yeah, I'm comfortable issuing.
I think it's
the grass is thin, you need to fix it, but it's your yard, you're going to want it fixed just as much as anybody.
Yep.
So the erosion isn't severe enough to hold up the certificate of compliance?
I don't think so.
I agree with you.
I mean, it's not like
even a
maximum
yard, you get this one little spot that's a little bare, just, you know.
So that's
you're going to do the right thing.
Okay.
I make a motion to issue an order of conditions for
270-0535.
270-05.
Second.
All those in favor? All those abstain? Did you get that, Chuck? 5-1. Okay. Do you have that to sign?
I do.
Wow.
I just want to mention, if people haven't signed in to the public meeting, there's a sign-in sheet, I think. Maybe?
Okay.
Is there one?
No,
all
there
right.
We'll have to get one over
that
there.
One? Gonna
the first item on the agenda is notice of intent for Simon's Way Reading Rifle and Revolver Club, and this is continued to February 8th at the applicant's request.
Ready?
You got it. Okay, thanks everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I turned everything off.
This is off?
I turned it off.
Dying.
I know, no, it was horrible when we walked in. It's like, oh.
Well, we could always ask engineering.
Yeah, right.
We could open the door, too.
The windows.
Good morning, Mike. You made good time.
Yeah, they were very safe. Yeah, it was like three of them.
Oh,
yeah, they
you made
and
it
safe
then.
It's very safe and
they
safe.
Good.
Really there's one guy that's scraping up everything.
Madam Chair, which one are we holding off on till later? It's
no, we're not.
Town?
I think we can do the town.
Repeatedly.
What about Simmons
yeah,
Way?
Cool.
Continued.
Yeah, I just said that.
Yeah.
So Van Horn?
I
don't know. Chuck, are we doing the town of Reading at this point, or are we waiting? Cause we've got Mike.
I think you should run through the list and say that Simon's Way and.
I did.
And then, Dana, you could do right now, and.
Dana, Van Norden?
Van Norden.
Van Norden.
Van Norden, 216.
Okay,
Van Norden, cause that's in order, and then the other two have been continued, so that would give you your opportunity for the DPW, for the engineering department.
All right, notice of intent, for 270-0677-116 Van Norden, map 39, lot 72, Dana. We have an order of conditions?
So we left it, we went through the entire discussion at the last meeting. I don't believe we closed, because you were worried if I was able to put it together or not, put the order together or not. It is prepared, so, we can close it and issue it if you want to. So, that's my update on that property.
But we haven't had the opportunity to review it?
You haven't had the opportunity to review it. You could take a minute now and look at it. You could, suggest some changes.
Is there anything in there, Chuck?
Probably should sign it, and, probably should sign it and make the changes, and I'll amend it.
Okay.
During the week.
Is there anything in there you think you should call attention to for us?
Well, it's, so the site is, it's not like a brand-new house. They're using the existing house, and they're going up and doing a garage under, and we really talked about,
How they were gonna
how we wanted some stuff done.
Demo that back wall.
I think we had a great discussion, but it's really not, although it's close to the wetland, it doesn't, to me, seem to have a problem. Jack, Sullivan is the engineer on that. He's gonna be watching the project, along with myself, so usually it's pretty controlled.
Yeah, and that access is a lot better than I thought it was. I drove by there after the meeting.
Right.
I don't have any concerns. I don't know if anybody else does.
Can I ask a couple of questions, just as, I'm sorry I couldn't make the meetings about this. There's two sheds in the back, are they?
One's being removed.
The other one's staying? What's happening to, is this a subdivided parcel?
Yes, they.
Okay, all right, yeah, I'm just trying to.
The truck was back there, remember that?
Yeah, I knew, I, yes.
Truck's gone.
I do remember the chip truck. Yes, I do.
Oh, it's Canes, that's right.
Was there any other areas of, not really, there really weren't too many. I mean, there was some superficial stored stuff behind the house. I remember that.
Yeah, that's all gonna.
That was probably.
That's all gonna get packed down with the construction and regraded.
And are there plantings as additional buffer between the property?
Right.
It's right here?
Yes. And there were trees.
Took care of everything while you were gone, Anik.
Hey, well, that's what I expect.
There were trees also, replacement for some of these trees that are being taken out there.
All right.
We should vote.
So, do I hear a motion to close the hearing?
Make a motion to close the hearing and, sign the order of conditions as is.
Second.
All those in favor?
Abstain.
Okay.
All right. Respectfully abstain.
Thank you.
So sign that, they're signing it now, and I'll send it out on Monday, certified mail, so look for that coming to you.
What do you have for an address?
Yeah, I was gonna ask you the same thing. It's in Stonem, is that the address you want?
Yes, you could just actually send it to my house since.
I don't have it in front of me, so I know it's 34, I don't know, 2 something, I don't know, what was it?
It's probably 12 Thompson Pond Road, sound about right?
Let's find out.
Yeah.
Is that right, Craig?
Yep.
We'll send it to this address.
Okay. All right, that's fine.
All right, and you asked when the 10 days starts, it starts tomorrow.
Tomorrow, okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
At 7:10, we have a continuation of notice of intent 270-0675, 364 Lowell Street, map 26, lot 157, Jameson. And that has been continued. Do we have any updates on that, Chuck?
No. It's the only conversation I had with Bill Manuel between now and the last meeting was about the fees. And
that still hasn't been resolved.
Well, he has, yeah, it's been resolved. He's just got to get the final numbers together. So that should be paid, you know, probably between now and the next meeting. And then there's that list of questions that we asked. So they're going to be putting that together.
Okay.
But they asked for two meetings to, you know, finish off the list, and that's basically all there is.
You folks are from the neighborhood.
Yes.
Did you know it was continued?
No.
No. We weren't that aware. Last time, and then you talked about it. So we missed. So we
right.
missed the last meeting. So we wanted to make sure we're up here for this meeting.
I know last time
I don't
that they applied that we were notified when they were going to have a meeting, and we didn't get any notifications.
When it gets continued, you don't get re-notified.
No, I mean in the first meeting that you had for this, this time, we
for
were
this
never
permit.
Notified.
Right. Yeah.
For this filing.
So
never notified? You weren't notified of the first one?
The first one, but not the second time.
Yeah.
No.
The new application.
It's
yeah.
come back from CDPC.
Because
they're required
can.
To notify for their notice of intent, to notify abutters.
Right.
Yeah.
Which you did get.
How far along they are. When you talk about fees, what are the fees
that they
are?
What fees
did they have to
say? Yeah, the fees were for different things next to the wetland, you know, so many square feet, and I don't know what they all were, and also
the variances to
the there was variance, I believe, and also trees. They're cutting a lot of trees.
Yeah.
So they had to go and figure out exactly what trees they were cutting over 6 inches in diameter at about 5 feet. That's a mature tree. And then we require, you know, a replacement. We have a tree replacement policy.
And there has all that already been approved then? Because the last we were here, it was you guys were doing a walkthrough. We saw you do the walkthrough on a Wednesday, I believe, Mike,
yes.
in the
right.
morning.
Yeah.
And that's, we never heard what came about of that walkthrough. And it sounds like after the walkthrough, some more decisions were made by you that were giving them the okay that we don't even know about.
We needed to see, like I just said, we needed to see what trees they were cutting
mm-hmm.
down, in what locations, and what they were doing for replication. They're taking out some historic fill, and I think that was discussed even the first meeting that we had that was on the plan. Any other update?
Were you guys at the last meeting?
No,
no,
we
were
notified.
You know, something tells me as soon as I asked, I should have known that. And, all right, so we did ask for a lot. You can, do you take advantage of RCTV on YouTube, and you could just watch the last meeting, and you could fast forward it?
I looked for the minutes, and they weren't up there on the website.
Yeah.
It would help if they check the minutes first.
Yeah. So I would go to RCTV and review the video of the last meeting.
Okay.
It's just YouTube. You'll probably go to their site, and then you would be up to date with what we asked for. But we did ask for a lot of information. They wanted to do some cleanup in the channel, and one of the things that we want to do is to understand exactly how they're going to do that. So that needs to be put together. Then they're going to do a tree inventory, and there's a couple other issues.
We've got replication in front of that fence area.
Yep.
Thank you.
And for the tree cut down and replacement, do we as the abutters have any, I'm not even going to say, but are we involved in some of that? Because it's obviously going to affect about 15 houses on one side and 15 on another.
So they obviously want to have a buffer.
Yeah. Yeah.
And they're not gonna cut down any trees between houses that they don't have to, but that's a great question for when we get the tree inventory.
Well, because it's, we don't have really trees, because if you, we have the wetland, right, all the trees are on the land that they presumably, you know, are not part of the wetlands.
All the trees are on the land where they're gonna cut down.
So, okay, great.
You know what I mean, we have with the swamp,
Some of the,
so, you know.
Now, and you can forward, fast forward, 'cause I didn't know.
Is that, they're gonna clean that up, I know, 'cause they wanna help us, they told us that, and I, you know, but I just wanna know if they're gonna like put trees up against that, 'cause, you know.
So, we haven't seen it,
Yeah, we haven't, you know, we're not there, you're trying to say you're jumping the gun, but we would need, so you're gonna see the trees that are on the site, and then the trees that are gonna be cut down with the houses that they're building and all the whatever, you know, structures and roads and stormwater structures on that, so you'll see what's coming down and what's not. I would, but I think that you're gonna find out some of those trees towards the front are gonna be gone, and you're gonna have, what are you gonna be looking at? I'm not sure, but it is on someone else's property.
It hasn't been presented to us yet, though.
Yeah.
And so we're still waiting for that to come in, and just, I don't think we, just so you don't go through 3 hours of an incorrect meeting.
Told that you can fast forward.
Well, I don't think this was last meeting either, I think it was the meeting prior to that, are we?
You're right.
I think you're right, too.
It was in December.
Okay, yes.
Right, yeah, okay.
Yeah, so.
Yeah, I don't think.
So, don't go sit and watch 3 hours of the last meeting, I don't think we're.
Rest assured, it's on the website now.
I think we continued it last, which would be the, like, 2 weeks ago.
Yeah, I don't remember, it wasn't discussed at the last meeting, unless it was after I went to the budget.
Right, so.
Can I just ask one question? Do you go back through, like, the last time that they went through this application and look through the records from that?
This has been going on for a while, before me, and I believe that Chuck.
Yeah, this was all shot down by conservation before, and now we're going through it again, and it sounds like you guys have already got it, well, it's got a stamp on this to have them build houses.
There was a lot of back and forth, even with Chuck, and I think that there were some compromises that were made, so, yep. But, thank you.
All right.
Thank you.
So who was the person that didn't get notified, what's your last name?
Hanson.
Hanson.
'Cause I have the list right here, do you mind giving me your address?
17 Plymouth.
Yeah, they have. You're on the list, you're on the abutters list, so we can ask them.
We did get notified the first application, but after that, it's kind of.
That's.
So when it gets continued, another notification.
Right.
No.
Was it, was it?
This was, from what I understand, the first application, they're about to be denied, and they withdrew their application.
Right, they withdrew it, you were on it.
They withdrew it because they're about, I think, about to fail.
Right.
So, now they come back, and.
Try to go through both conservation and they have it together.
I think they've done this because of the weather, and you can't really assess that wetlands right now because it's all frozen.
Can't really discuss it, they're not here.
Okay, yeah, okay.
Yeah.
I was notified just now, we can't really discuss this because the applicant's not here.
I mean, all good points, but, you know, they're not here to hear this, so it's, it really has to be an open meeting.
When they come before us again, they're gonna come before us with the things that we've asked for, is the right time, we'll open up the meeting.
Okay.
And you know when, so we know when?
They it says on the agenda, they've continued to February 8th.
February 8th.
Oh, I thought it was normally afterwards, I said February.
And I just looked in the agenda from the last meeting, it was continued on the last meeting, so it went before us in the last meeting on the 11th, so.
It was.
Right.
Okay.
It was the meeting in December.
But can you, seriously, check with Chuck before the meeting and make sure that they're coming in? I don't want you folks to, you know, come back out and just sit there.
Okay.
Yep.
December meeting was December 14th.
Yeah.
We didn't know about it, yeah.
Just thinking you're gonna say exactly what I'm gonna tell them.
Okay, well.
Do you wanna say it?
No, go ahead.
Okay, thank you.
So, there's another step you could do, if you sign up at the clerk's office, you can get all the agendas to all the boards emailed to you when they're posted, so you don't have to look.
Okay.
So, you could just, I don't know if you have to come in, maybe you can call, I'm not sure, but obviously you would check off Conservation Commission.
We just don't wanna miss another meeting.
Right, but, you know.
So exciting.
Thank you.
Please give me a call, that's.
And if it's on the agenda, you're always free to call Chuck and just say, hey, you know, I wanna make sure they're actually coming in. He usually has an idea.
Let's do it.
Are you here during the day so we can come?
I am, yeah.
Just Friday they're off, so Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You said it more eloquently than I could.
720 continued notice of intent 270-0676 Low Meadow, map 14, lot 15, Haskell, continued to February 8th at the applicant's request. And I guess we have some new business, the dewatering on West Street from the town engineering department. Did you guys have an opportunity to look at that? I came over.
I can go down and grab it.
It was a little bit late today.
Yeah, I looked at it.
So I was not able.
I looked at some of it.
I didn't get a chance.
I emailed it to him.
Dewatering of
contaminated
soil along West Street. They believe
it's. Put it on the thumb drive? I'll be right back.
Start from the beginning?
Yeah.
They don't mind. They don't mind. I forgot to put this on my thumb drive, so can I?
Yeah. So Anika, now would be the time to talk about the budget meeting.
Okay, all right, so as you all know, I excused myself from the last meeting to go to the budget presentations over at Senior Center, and the result, my takeaway was every town department or every town entity that had a say, had some budget item, everybody needed additional money for additional services. And we know we're facing a challenging budget situation. It was pointed out in a slide that conservation doesn't have a dedicated meeting minutes taker. Jean Delios said that we've been surviving, getting by, trying to make do. And to just contribute to that comment, I spoke up and told the selectmen that during one of our meetings, we had some level of discussion among ourselves about how are we going to take these minutes? Can we submit the minutes by video? Can we do maybe something like a voice to text to at least get a draft minutes automatically done? Use some sort of technology to assist and reduce our labor load. And that sparked a brief but energetic discussion by the selectmen who sounded interested in that. And Bob Lelisher chimed in about what was legal and lawful and what was not. And it was just a high level discussion. It really didn't get into a thorough nitty gritty about what our options were, but
I didn't get an answer if the video was good enough.
No, well, yeah, I think.
Didn't he say it wasn't?
I got a sense that Bob Lelisher said it wasn't allowable.
Video wasn't allowable.
Singly, only, that some written form must be provided. So I don't know where we're at with that, but
is that because
I did tell the selectmen that we're trying to make the best of a bad situation here, and we're trying to be resourceful about it. We're trying to think about better ways to do this, and so
we need some guidance from them about what's legal and what's not, so that we can figure out the best thing to do within the limits of the law. Because if the law says certain things have to be recorded in writing, which is, I'm guessing, why he objected to video, then tell us exactly what needs to be put in writing. We'll put that in writing and we'll say, see the video first.
Well, I think we can have those discussions. I don't think it necessarily, I didn't think that was the right place
to have that
discussion. And, I think we can do that more efficiently and effectively through Chuck at Town.
I think what
Chuck
has to be
Town
in writing
Hall.
Is a brief synopsis of, who came in, they came in, they filed a notice of intent, they gave some comments, we made a motion
points.
And approved.
Yeah,
we don't, it doesn't have to be, word for word. I mean, from my, I know at least a half a dozen conservation commissions in Massachusetts that don't take minutes at all. A lot of them just put it on a recorder that they never transcribe and doesn't pick up, you know, 70%.
I don't know how much of this is our own town bylaw and our own regulations we impose on ourselves.
I couldn't imagine there'd be a bylaw saying that we have to put things in writing. It's gotta be open meeting law, but I've never seen it enforced in 30 years, so. I think a synopsis so we don't kill ourselves.
In between.
What we're trying to do right now, I think, is not working.
Recording.
And I think we need to simplify it.
Yeah.
I think it's still worth pursuing a more efficient, more effective way.
I agree.
That video should be more than sufficient. That's a permanent record of exactly who was there and what was said. I mean.
But I think what you're running into is there was a law passed in 1972.
Yeah, 1970,
that says it's
good
as well,
1980.
We always used to record our meetings, but we always had meeting minutes.
I mean, 1880, not 1970.
Well,
yeah.
But I've watched a number of our meetings, and not everything is said clearly or loudly,
but
and so it's not all caught necessarily.
But you get the gist of it.
But the thing
you
is
do
is
get
is
the gist of it, and
all of the things that are said are not germane to be placed on minutes anyway.
Right. True.
So really,
it doesn't have to be much more
than really a fluid flesh out of our agenda.
What they were here for.
Could be
what was
our minutes.
What the salient points
that's
were.
That's even too much.
Who
can
you
know,
have,
was this,
but I,
here's
I,
the list?
I don't think we're
going
to get anywhere with this until we talk to the
right.
town clerk.
All right, so.
A representative of
yep.
the board, Chuck, or someone else who wants to step up, who wants to talk to the town clerk.
You're into it now. You're
I'm not, I'm just a
no,
voice.
You're very hard to get a hold of.
So from a budget standpoint, did they basically say, suck it up, buttercup, or is it?
I didn't see any substantial conclusions that night.
Okay.
And honestly, I think the
so
meetings
it was an
are going
to
continue.
Raise an issue?
Yeah.
It was an opportunity to raise an issue, and that was about it.
Good opportunity to oh man, we lost that. Nothing else, right? But I think everybody's got sacrificed.
They didn't take our money. We had some money in our budget, and they didn't ask for it this year. They're going to let us build up some of our resources.
Don't worry.
We had about 5,000. No, they said no.
Next year, when they see this 15 grand in there, they're going to
Part of Gene's presentation was for each town department was to tell a little vignette about what that department is doing for the common citizen to provide a service to them. And in one case, she talked about Chuck going out and doing a delineation for a woman who wanted to move into an in-law apartment in the middle of winter, and it was just a very clear delineation, and she ended with, because he did this, he spent a couple hours going out and helping her, she was able to move into her,
hey, we're just
and which is good. It's good to show what service we're providing. So, that's that. Okay.
So how do we find out exactly what the minimum requirements are for this town? Do we have to go to Laura?
Mm-hmm.
I think Laura Jemmy, town clerk, would be the authority on what's required for the minutes.
They're gonna refer that out to town council.
Well, that's okay. We'll start with Laura.
She may have gone through that process already. Because the town has moved its whole system over to electronic.
Why are we bending over backwards when we're not funded? Why don't we just do the best we can? And if that's not good enough for them in 5 years, they don't like our minutes. Well, you should have gave us somebody.
Well, I did talk to Gene Delios behind the scenes about can we get a very motivated high schooler who to come in and.
I hope you were talking about.
Oh, that's confidence. To show up, and there's some ambitious
the two attachments
people in town
you sent
would be
me.
Willing
okay.
to get
that's
that
what you're talking
hourly
about.
Pay.
Yep. Not the memo.
I
a couple times a month.
Oh, I thought you were talking about volunteer. That's why.
No, I'm not talking about a volunteer. I'm talking about
that's
literally
right.
finding a body to be trained to sit there and
right there, right?
And
not that far off.
Do the minutes.
It's not too far out of the ballpark.
What is, the hourly pay scale?
No, no. We can talk about it later.
The National Honor Society have to do
Was there a plan in this?
A community component.
Some community service?
And I know that some kids would relish the thought of doing that, just coming and taking annotated notes rather than going out and having to meet people like out in the community.
But I think
so that's one way that you could do it.
But that's also, that hiring process goes through town hall, and I think there's an internal town hall process in terms of who is offered what when. So that's not in our hands.
I just lose it.
Could dock Chuck's pay and take some of that money and put that towards.
It's all true.
Yeah, that's a great idea.
Are we all set? I'll work with him. He'll have me 24/7.
Hey,
learn
what's
the trade.
Next?
All right, never mind. I'll pay.
Where's Mike going?
Well, we have.
Hold on a second. So I'm going to just start filling in my sheet. So we're going to be talking about West Street.
West Street dewatering.
Is this near Arcadia?
No, this is all the way down the end of West Street.
Which end?
Down heading towards Wilmington.
We have the survey.
Yeah, we have Avalon Apartments.
They took four.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
I don't know which one.
RMLD's property.
Okay.
Does this have to do with the water main extension or any work the MWR is doing?
This was a previously approved.
Oh, this is the pump station?
Yes, correct.
Oh, okay.
So this is just a, presenting the dewatering plan as you guys wanted to see.
Oh, for that design.
So is this going to start soon? Is this funded and ready to go?
It has started. We've driven the sheet piles in, we've excavated some material out, and we're at the point.
Oh, really?
We need to dewater, so.
Great.
So the West Street Pump Station project.
So under the order of conditions, the approval from the commission. Dewatering, so that's why we're bringing that forward tonight, in hopes that we can begin dewatering tomorrow.
Is the highway right away somewhere in there?
No.
You want me to go and get it on the other map?
No.
The other one?
It's further to the left.
Yeah, we're quite a distance away from the highway.
Can you, do you know where you're experiencing the water table at this point? How deep?
I think we experienced it somewhere around 8 feet, correct? Which was indicated on the moorings.
Yes.
That's
yeah.
Right.
We got 7 now.
Oh.
Yeah. So
even
we
with the rains.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I'm sorry. What exactly is the excavation for?
So
the pump station.
The
new
project,
pump station
the,
building.
The project is we're rehabilitating a pump station.
Okay.
So we're rebuilding a pump station. Right now we have to demolish the old one, keep the old one up and running at the same time that we're putting in the new one. We've driven sheet piles with bracing. We've excavated some material, and we're at the point where we need to dewater.
So you're at 8 feet down.
Yeah, we encountered groundwater.
Chuck, can you help me understand what?
Yeah, I think we all need a little bit of context, like what exactly are you doing and why and.
So we've brought this forward to the Conservation Commission prior. We already have an order of conditions where we've been approved to fix a pump station that's in severe decline, and we've already done one on Batch Elder Road that's under construction at the moment as well, and this is also part of the same contract where we've done the excavation. Right now we've demolished, we're actually have one of the stations on temporary. They're in a temporary mode right now, so we're at the point where the new one has to go in.
So this is a sewer pumping station?
Correct.
Okay.
Sewer pump station.
The municipal employees doing this work, or is it
no,
subcontracted out?
This has been contract bid with Albanese DNS, and our design consultant, CDM Smith, is overseeing.
Okay.
When you originally filed this notice of intent, did you anticipate, is it contaminated?
So there wasn't anticipation because RMLD had had some issues with it being a contaminated site at one point, that we had an item in there for contamination. The borings did not indicate at that point how extensive or if any contamination. When we did excavate, we had an odor. When we encountered that odor, we dealt with it appropriately and it stockpiled appropriately per regulation, off-site, not in the buffer zone area.
And that odor was a petroleum kind of product, or was it?
It's an odor. At this moment, we've tested, once you smell it, we've taken the precautions to treat it as such, and we've tested it. GZA, your consultant?
Yes.
Has tested it. We're just waiting back those.
So you don't know what it is?
It could be, you know, it could be petroleum-based, it could be whatever that is. I don't know what the limits are, I don't know, we're waiting those back. We should get them back by tomorrow. But that's just for the soil, and we'll treat that accordingly when we need to. It has not been stockpiled on-site.
So that soil's gone?
That soil is currently being stockpiled per regulation in a secure DPW facility.
Mm-hmm.
Jersey barriers around it, on polypropylene. And we've already tested it before it even came out of the ground.
Yeah.
So we're just awaiting the test to find out where we can dispose and how we dispose of it properly.
So as you excavation proceeds, are you going to segregate the additional soil you encounter? Or
that will go into the secure stockpile area that
yep.
we have right now until we come to the point where we're confident that we're not in the contaminated soils anymore, and then we'll deal with the surplus soil at that point.
So the
intent is that, and the preferred method is that the soils that do come out go back in before you send them out somewhere else. So whatever surplus can go back into the hole that it came out of, go back.
Are you getting professional advice from an LSP?
GZA has been
hired by
the contractor.
And they're providing?
CDM Smith is on the town side as consultant for review. They also have an LSP.
Okay, so there is an LSP overseeing this.
Yes. And we also have representation from CDM Smith for the town side here tonight.
Okay.
Too.
All right.
So currently you've got the excavation 8 feet below, right at the top of groundwater.
Correct.
And so you're ready to put in an internal sump and start dewatering the inside of the excavation.
Correct.
And just so I get an idea of... I didn't realize the plan was stuffed in there.
It was buried in
there.
I missed it too.
So the cut is the weathered bedrock's around like 14 feet. You're going another 10 feet into that rock.
Yeah, that's fair to say. I think we're going down around
24 feet.
Yeah.
24 feet.
Yep.
Okay. So the pit, you're obviously going to try to keep on extending that all the way down to the top of rock, and then once you get to that point, it's just kind of keeping it up as you can. And everything you pump, you're proposing to put in the two frac tanks?
So the proposal is that we will pump the groundwater into two frac tanks. It'll
yep.
go through two frac tanks. We have the ability to either put out between 40 to 100 GPM out of those and regulate the flow accordingly. And then from that discharge, there was two options that were proposed,
mm-hmm.
and you would have thought that in the dewatering plan.
Yep.
The recommendation from CDM is to accept option number one, which would be to go into an infiltration basin. For numerous reasons, one being that that does not require a separate discharge permit, and it's also in compliance with the EPA and DEP as far as being within 100 feet of the excavation.
From a timing standpoint, how long is the excavation open? How long?
I would say a few weeks. The faster they get in there and the weather permits, the faster they get out.
Yep.
There are a multitude of things that,
take a while to
contribute to how fast they excavate. So.
Well, it's going to take a while to get through all that rock.
Sheeting has been driven through,
yes.
correct? So
yes.
it is fractured. We anticipated it as fractured in weather.
Yeah.
And it did show that in the borings as well. So
you want to shut it off?
Yeah, it's like behind you or something.
I don't anticipate it being too difficult to get through that section.
No, it's this one, but this one was cool.
It's off, it's just hot in here.
So.
No, I shut two of them off.
You know, my general take on the dewatering and the recharge, you know, seeing the location now and understanding it, I don't have a huge issue. The one thing I would bring up is I would, if an LSP has been brought on to understand the contamination, I would just want to make sure the same LSP has some sort of, you know, information or has been consulted on, this is the approach you're trying to take. Because same thing, it's difficult to say, you know, it may or may not be contaminated, but my take is we want to understand what exactly you've got.
Yeah, and this means of discharging, it works whether it's contaminated or not contaminated.
Absolutely.
So it is the preferred method to discharge of the groundwater.
Let me ask a real basic question because I don't do this for a living. The water that you're putting in the frac tank, what takes out, or is that something that you separate the contaminated?
Essentially, it's they're settling basins.
Yeah.
So
okay. It'll
go through and have a detention time, and they'll settle out whatever suspended solids it can at that point, which will in a sense reduce the amount of obviously sediment that you have in there, but also particulates that are attracted to that sediment. Correct me if I'm wrong, but
you're correct.
And doing that, we can also regulate the time of the discharge and extend the detention time in those frac tanks.
So the discharge the discharge you're putting back into the groundwater, right?
Correct.
Does that take out the contaminated chemicals that are
entirely? No.
Does that water get tested? Are these frac tanks going to be tested prior to discharge? Does this water get tested as it's getting pumped out? Is there any sample of the water that's been collected?
Nope. It gets discharged within 100 feet back in, infiltrated back into the site at which it was taken out of.
What is the nature of the nearby contamination that caused you to put a caveat in the contract documents in the first place?
If I remember correctly, RMLD had some PCBs on
right.
the site.
Right.
There was also a generator that was part of the pump station. So there is a unit price in there for hazardous material removal in our contract, anticipating that there might be something there.
Like some sort of fuel line
possibly,
or something
possibly.
Like that.
We won't know entirely what that is composed of until we get back the soil analytics.
I do have some background in the hazardous waste site activity in Massachusetts. I know that one of the precepts of the hazardous waste regulations is people in the state are, it is illegal to move contaminants from one place and thereby make a cleaner place more contaminated. Do you know what I'm saying?
If it's not in stockpile per regulation.
Well,
if you're moving to dispose, that is correct.
Well, which is what is happening with this water. And
this water is being recharged back into the same site that it came out of. It's not being disposed of.
But it's a form of it's dewatering. Well, dewatering disposal. You know, dewatering is the function it's serving, but effectively you're disposing it by recharging it into the ground. That is the effective.
Within regulation, you are allowed to put back the soil and groundwater that comes out of the exact same area that you're in.
That's not necessarily true.
Not necessarily true, but it's the preferred method for when you encounter things this nature.
It depends on the extent of the contamination.
Yeah, so we consulted Mass DEP on the regulations for groundwater recharge, and if you're recharging on a site that is anticipating less than 10,000 gallons per day, you're allowed to recharge into the same area as long as you're within 100 feet of where you're dewatering from.
Regardless of the level of contamination?
Yes.
So
not consider, as long as you're taking it and putting it back into the same aquifer.
And how many thousands of gallons are we talking about here? Under 10?
Not that much. It might be 8,000 gallons.
But.
It might be 8,000 gallons.
But I'm a little, but I'm a little, if no water testing is being done, how can you prove that it's not making a potential situation worse? Do you know what I'm saying?
One of the stipulations is it cannot go in any dirtier than it came out. And if you're taking out groundwater from one area and it's going back in, it's.
You're saying it's all the same.
It's
kind of like
any dirtier than, it's
you take it out of this side of the pot, you put it into this side of the pot.
Correct, it's going through a frac system, so essentially it will be cleaner. It will not be void of any contamination. And to say that we're not testing is not entirely true. We are testing the soil that the groundwater has migrated through, so.
If the soil results come back that trigger, just gonna play hypothetical. If the soil results did come back that triggered notification to DEP, making this a new site, what happens then? Because those soil results come back when?
It'll first be reportable to DEP, and then we'd have to go through those guidelines at that point.
Yeah, I wouldn't wish it on anybody in the town.
Right.
I'm just, you know, with the history of the area.
I mean, that's all a pretty regimented process, going through the MCP.
It is, but it's also under the jurisdiction of the licensed site professional for the project.
Right.
So, who is not here to share the information, and I hope that all the results come back fantastically for your sake.
We all do.
And for the town's sake.
We all do. I mean, the town has had this reviewed by CDM, who is acting as a LSP and the design consultant on the town side. They've recommended this dewatering plan and have approved this back and went through the background of checking. The contractor as well has sent it through their engineers.
Yes.
And it's come recommended in this manner.
Yes.
GSI
was who we consulted with for testing for analytical.
Mm-hmm.
My name is Paul. I'm with Albanese DNS. And we are currently working on the MWA project in Reading as well. So we've been in Reading for probably over a year at this point. And we enjoy working in town. It's a great town to work in. We hope to get more work in the town. We finished Batch Elder as far as our excavation work. That was very successful. And now we've moved on to West Street. Essentially, we olfactory method said, hey, this stuff smells bad. So what are we gonna do about it? Well, CDM Smith did a nice job with the specs. They have an item for hazardous materials, pay item. So we spoke to them and said, this stuff smells bad. What do you recommend? They said, we recommend we test it. We called GZA, who we feel are one of the top in the state. GZA reported to the job Friday morning and they took a sample. We're awaiting results. I personally took it upon myself to expedite the results. I should have them tomorrow morning. In the spec, it says it's not anticipated, but you may find PCB materials because of whatever's on RMLD's property, whatever happened in the past. I don't want to speak out of school, but something happened over there. So we can't just get rid of the material in somebody's backyard. We can't do that. It's not good for the town, not good for the engineer, not good for us. So we had to get it tested. So waiting results. And as far as the groundwater, not our first rodeo, but we took it upon ourselves to get the frac tanks there Friday morning. We need to move forward. We need to get the pump station in the ground. We're halfway there with excavation. So we thought it would be best to just get the frac tanks there. Now, due to the weather the last couple of days, we haven't worked. So essentially, our plan was to pump into the frac tanks. The question is discharge. Ultimately, from our experience and from what GZA and CDM Smith and the town has, you know, we've had a nice few meetings over the phone and in person, we can recharge. We've done it before. As long as we're within 100 feet. From the sketch that we put together, we're 79 feet from the excavation.
So we're well within upgrading from the allowable for recharging. That's for groundwater, for potential contaminated soil area. That's our plan. We've done it before, we feel confident in it, but ultimately we wanted to formally present it to the town, to the engineer, and now to your board. And that's where we are.
So, just to get back on where, that was a great explanation, thank you, because I think that's kind of what we were lacking.
One element, I'm sorry,
no,
Michael. One element that I forgot to mention is we took on our PE that we've used for many years, GSI, Harry Weatherby, who's very experienced in dewatering from an analytical standpoint. And we combined with between GSI, GZA, CM Smith, the town of Reading, Ryan's been great. We thought we'd come together with all these great forces and come up with the best solution for what's best for the town and for this area. So that's where we are right now.
So, like I said, I'm glad you gave the summary. I think what a lot of us were sitting here wondering is, I think this came before the commission. I don't think I was on the commission when this came before.
No.
So that means
it was probably
so,
early 2015.
Yeah,
so
that's about
right. So there were a lot of us that just had no clue what was going on here. Mm-hmm. So we just wanted to try to get a background.
And we got this information. I did take a look through it, but it was about 2 hours ago. You know?
It did come in late. I mean, this is all unfolding.
That's all right. We're just trying to do our
job
and you're trying to do yours. So
where
the
is the
we
wetlands?
Take care of it, the faster that stockpile goes away.
To the right, Mike. Do you see it flagged?
No, oh yeah, this is like a stream.
Right.
This?
Nope,
no,
to the right.
To the right.
The
thank you,
flag.
I'm not doing that right from that, obviously.
The other right.
To the right. Where
right
is it? Is it
yeah.
And
this
the
is,
previous
okay, this
21E site?
Here, and these are the buffer
the PCB
zones.
Site? Isn't it kind of in the vicinity of those two frac tanks? The previous limits? Previous site boundary?
I think it was off to the north. I think it was left of the trail.
Yeah, I think so. Where
it's
the exact
the
limits are, I don't know.
Because
the area where the frac tanks are now is currently where the pole yard was. So where the poles were stored, we removed those poles and talking to the RMLD to use this as a storage area. Because the site is limited with the high tension power lines that we have there.
Right.
So that's where we are now. So. They wouldn't have stockpiled on their poles, so that stockpile is further north, I think, point John.
The stockpiled excavation soil?
The stockpile that, whatever the contamination was from RMLD, where that was exactly, I don't know. But it was not in that area where we're storing the frac tanks. It was close, but not in that area.
Yeah, I'm just... A piece of me is wondering, what do you know about the soil quality in the area you're going to infiltrate?
GSI reviewed that, and he said we should have no problem recharging based on the borings given in the specifications. We should have no issue recharging into the infiltration basin. Based on the borings.
Yeah, I'd like to see some of those reports. I'm interested in seeing the data, the analytical results. I assume you tested for PCBs, but I don't know if what
ran
if
the whole, we ran the whole gamut.
Whole gamut, a full disposal.
Full
disposal
yes,
characterization.
Yes,
there was a specified requirement in the spec as to what
right.
they had to test for,
right.
and they followed that requirement. Mm-hmm.
And that's a soil sample.
Soil sample. In situ.
Yeah, and as
we
you said before, no groundwater samples have been collected.
No.
Okay. Well, I'm not familiar with that disposal technique. It doesn't mean it's invalid. I'm just unfamiliar with that. You know, 100-foot rule, less than 10,000 gallon, 100-foot rule. But it does give me some degree of confidence that two LSPs have been involved and reputable engineering companies have been involved in the process. That does give me some degree of confidence. that things are being done appropriately.
If I may, CDM Smith also checked with DEP, and if I'm not mistaken, Tom Casey said EPA as well.
Yep.
Well, you have to, yeah, when you're talking about PCBs, and if you're expecting, there are EPA thresholds for PCBs. At least there were last week. I don't know what's going to happen next.
Thresholds for
next week, but you know, there are, yeah, if you hit a certain threshold in the EPA, in soils, all of a sudden, instead of it just a state site, it becomes a federal site. You don't want to go there, cost-wise, but you have to.
I will tell you that whatever happens with the soils, it will be handled appropriately. We're all on board with doing the right thing as far as that's concerned. Part of the reason why we stockpiled in a secure location and not back on that site was because we are within 100-foot. It didn't make sense to actually stockpile it, to be honest with you.
Ryan, let me ask a question. How many gallon frac tank is that, and how long does it take to fill it up?
1,000 gallons. They're 21,000 gallons each. It's right on the, and it takes.
So it's 42,000 gallons.
I think the estimate was 8,000 gallons a day. 8,000, it's not.
So how long does it take approximately to, I mean, is there time to do your job, fill up that frac tank, and wait till we get the results before we discharge it?
No.
If we're going to hear the results tomorrow, is that going to be filled and emptied tomorrow?
How quickly will that start?
That sounds like a lot more than 10,000 a day.
Yeah.
How long will that start to discharge? By the end of the day? Start?
I think it depends on what the potential time is that we know.
Right.
But the initial ground water, already now it's a little high. Once you pump it down, then the amount should be filling low.
I didn't catch that.
So obviously now the void is full of groundwater at this
right.
point. So the initial volume is going to be a quick burst of volume, and then as we get down and pump it down,
right.
it's not going to be pouring in as, you know, it's not going to be as much volume coming into the frac tank. I can't answer your question whether or not we'll be discharging by the end of the day tomorrow.
I don't think so.
You don't think so?
No, we got plenty of storage.
I had one question about the water. Just for the sake of argument, if it was found that there was PCBs in the soils,
mm-hmm.
would the regulation allowing the dewatering and recharging within 100 feet of the excavation, if PCBs were found, would that still apply, or would you have to then take another action to treat the water for the PCBs?
My understanding would still apply. Yeah, it would still
it
apply.
Would still
my
apply?
Understanding is
okay.
it goes back in and infiltrates from the
same exact
pot
place.
That you took out of.
Mm-hmm.
And that is the method they want. They don't
want
to bring
pocket and put in your right pocket. You still have your money.
Right.
So, yeah, I get that. But I didn't know whether that triggered an additional regulation.
No, it's a valid question, and to be honest with you, that was the same question that I had asked CDM Smith, and they had actually went in contact.
So, what would have to happen
can I
with this test results?
Hang on a sec, just a quick sec. So one of the natures of PCBs is it's the type of chemical that only loves to stick to soil.
Soil, right.
So it's not a water lover. So even in some highly contaminated PCB sites, the only water that tends to get a huge PCB concentration in it is one that's muddy.
Right.
So after you've got it settled out, the real residual contamination
right.
is associated with
the
soil.
Bottom of
so,
the frac tank.
So
right.
once the tanks have settled out, depending on the concentrations of other.
So maybe Anika, you can answer this if they can't.
Oh, go ahead.
What would have to happen in these test results that would not allow you to discharge this 79 feet from where it's coming from, under 10,000 gallons? What's the scenario that would make that impossible? What type
of
thing?
In the eyes of DEP, nothing.
In the eyes of DEP, nothing?
Yeah. We don't. In the eyes of DEP, we don't need a permit to recharge the water under these conditions.
But we don't know what the.
But these conditions meaning the ton.
But we don't know what the conditions are.
Well, these conditions meaning the under 10,000 gallons a day and within 100 feet of the dewatering site.
No matter what the test results on the water show?
Yeah.
I'm.
But I thought you said that, just a correction,
Yeah, I'm not sure about that either.
And then Mike chimed in, depending on the extent of the contaminants, you were able to do that. Is there something I missed? So when you were talking about,
I think that might have been in regard to soil.
Soil.
I think the contaminants will affect the soil more than the groundwater.
And in the soil, you will have to dispose of.
The soil will be, yeah.
Correctly, depending on the severity of the.
Level of contamination, right.
Or the levels of contamination.
Who did you talk to at DEP about this?
Our LSP, actually, Kate Murphy talked to them.
At DEP?
At DEP, yeah. She pointed me to the website, though, and I can probably find that.
Yeah.
It is online.
So you stockpile on the soil, and no matter what, you can always discharge the water, as far as DEP.
Depending on what the characterization of the soil turns out to be from the soil testing, will determine what we do with the soil, where it can go.
So it sounds like that water's going back on the ground, no matter what this test says tomorrow.
Yes.
So what do you do with the stuff in the bottom of the frac tank?
It goes back to Ryan's house.
That will also be disposed of properly, same place that the soil.
How many yards is stockpiled right now, approximately, right?
The maximum amount of stockpile that I know of that can come out of this excavation hole will be about 300 cubic yards, roughly.
Plus some flow.
350 yards,
compressed
maybe?
300 cubic yards.
So what exactly is this application for? Do we need to, Chuck, make a formal approval, or
we've been presented the plan, and in our order of conditions, we've been asked to review and approve their dewatering plan. So they're looking for an approval from this commission tonight on the plan that's been presented to you.
Do I hear a motion?
I'll make a motion to approve as submitted.
I would just make an amendment. If the recharge, if the volume pumped ends up being greater than anticipated, so greater than the 10,000, if you think you need another recharge area, or the recharge area starts, you know, sometimes if you're pumping for a long time, they stop functioning and you need to move it, we want to know.
Sure.
I would like to be informed.
Sure.
I'd like to make should we vote on that amendment? I have no objections to that amendment. But I'd like to make another amendment that we get copies of, or CC'd on, at least digitally,
sure.
on correspondence, so you don't have to go make paper copies mm-hmm. for us, but just keep us up to date with
as soon as we get
the
results
analytical
back,
results and
absolutely.
The
I'll
LSP
share them with,
decisions.
I'll share them with Chuck, and
he can email them out to us. Yep.
Yep.
That's what I'm most interested in, is the analytical results and the LSP decisions.
Sure. And we'll
or opinions.
We should hopefully receive those from GZA in a timely fashion as soon as the results come back.
Okay. And sometimes
Paul was gracious enough to expedite, so
yeah.
That'll be sooner than later.
Might be sometime tonight as well.
So just so I'm clear, you won't start dewatering until you get soil results back?
No, they're going to dewater.
They're going to dewater. Because they can put it back.
We have a contingency plan set in place for our stockpile for soils.
Okay.
They've been tested.
All right. Okay.
The disposal of soils is what
Separate.
We're holding off
yep.
on.
Okay. All right.
And we're not dewatering until we brought this plan for approval.
Got
so
it.
Once we get approval, we will start continuing to excavate and dewater. Because at this point, we just stopped.
Okay.
Didn't proceed.
Can I ask a couple more details about the recharge area?
Sure.
Is there a special construction of that, or is that literally, how is that area going to
be
prepared? Or
we're going to excavate it out 8 by 25 by 4 feet deep. Andrea, we'll put a stone in there.
Yeah.
Put some stone. We're going to stockpile the dirt we get out of it, and then when we're all done, we'll put the same soil back.
Okay, do we have that in writing somewhere?
Yes, I believe it's in the actual
plan.
Because I didn't see it in, is that in the memo?
I think
or?
It was in the amendment to the dewatering plan. It was a CDM common, I think, on my response. I said that.
Okay.
I didn't.
last night, I think I responded.
Actually, note on that drawing, on the
Soil that came out.
Yeah, okay.
Something like that, I responded.
I'm having trouble reading it at the moment.
I can't see, I can't read that.
The drawing says recharge area 8x25x4.
Going to that space.
That's all it says about that.
Okay, all right, I just.
The straw bottles.
Somebody second those motions.
Yeah, some two amendments.
Yeah.
Who?
Somebody second it.
I'll second.
That sounded like you.
Oh, no, I made the motion.
You made the motion, who's?
I moved and seconded the motion.
Mike and Harry?
You put me down as a second.
Yeah, and Mike, yeah.
For both motions, or?
Yeah.
One, two.
All those in favor?
Okay.
Yeah, please be clear that this is not going into the, any waterway or into our catch basins at all, so.
Well, that helps.
But one thing I will say, though, despite the contamination, despite all the other issues, is that this was a 24-foot cut with groundwater 7 feet deep, so you knew dewatering was gonna occur either way.
We did.
Getting the dewatering plan in.
You are correct. Town is aware of that and have addressed it.
Okay.
Thank you.
Anytime we can get things well in advance of the meetings is much appreciated. I understand you're under time constraint, but.
I agree.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
I appreciate you hearing this on short notice. That is
Yeah.
a big plus.
Thanks for putting it in English for us.
I'll probably owe Chuck some parking spaces, I think.
Yeah. we'll think of something.
Writing?
Yeah, I'm sure it's coming. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Have a good night.
We'll make that part of the decisions. Yes, thank you.
Good night.
Good night.
So let's take on
14 Strawberry Hill Lane.
Thank you.
There's an extension for another year.
I gave him a year. I mean, you can try to pigeonhole it or make it smaller, but he's
Is that why work has stopped out there?
No, it's just.
Hasn't been working
just,
out there in a couple weeks.
They were out today.
Oh, they were there today?
For how long is it?
At least trucks were there and people were standing outside.
No, that has nothing
people.
To do with this extension. I don't know why they're stopped.
Okay.
They're doing stuff though.
They're moving along. He thinks he'll be done midsummer.
What's actually done?
The structure's up. It's
structure.
Roofed.
Framed.
So it's framed.
It's framed. And there's.
They're working on the frame. The frame's not finished.
Do they have any of the? I don't know if you know this, but do they have any of the? They have the. There was a pipe from the driveway running down to the backyard. Is that in?
Yeah.
We could do a site visit on the next meeting.
That sounds okay to me.
But if
so
he's
you haven't had any issues with them so
time.
Far for
he's chugging along, he's building the house.
There's activity on
this is a couple of guys that I first met when I first got here, and I don't think one thing I've asked these people to do in the 5 years I've been here they've ever not done. They still have a healthy fear of conservation.
Okay. I make a motion to extend the
second.
All those in favor? Okay.
And here's extension.
Oh, certificate of compliance for artists.
That is still on hold.
Hey, who's going to the open house?
I'm going, and I'm wearing a big name badge that says Harry Curtis Conservation Commission.
I think it's kind of lost in the, you know, between the contractors leaving and management taking over. But, you know, we have a $20,000 bond. So I guess we can give them a deadline and then start hiring people to finish off what we want for our project.
Have you received any update on moving those bounds and doing those fixes we listed
out? Nope.
Well, can they get
nothing.
Can they occupy
when, what's his name, Jim?
He may have already signed.
So many Jims. Well, when the site contractor left, which was... think of the name now that they're gone, but anyways, it was fast and furious when he was trying to get this closed out, and
right.
He was left town and on to his next project, and I haven't heard. But it is not his responsibility. The order of condition was written to artist.
Yeah.
So he was just trying to facilitate that.
So at this point, we don't have a contact, do we?
No, I mean, I think, I'm not concerned so much. The spring's coming, they're doing some projects, there'll be a time when it comes back to thinking about this. I mean, just think about this. They just finished a site. It was a year and plus trying to get this thing together. And now they're trying to get it, you know, people in there and it operational. So they got a lot on their plate. I think as soon as that period's over, they'll find out what the cleanup is. I can shoot them an email. We do have a contact, and they can work on it.
The right time to excavate that mound, though, in that area that was elevated, is probably
before
spring.
Before spring? Oh, well.
No.
Right.
You do spring, you can do late summer. I mean, that's when it is. I mean, I am in no rush to close this out. I think that just watching that vegetated area, the constructed wetland for another year is fine with me. It could be fine. You're right, they could go in now, or they could go in, you know, late summer.
We've got a $20,000 bond that we're holding, what you said.
Yeah.
So at the end of the day, if they don't do something, we've got the ability to do something.
And we hired, was it Hayes?
Yeah.
We hired Hayes?
No, we asked that they were environmental monitors.
And so did they work for us, or did they work for?
They work for them, but report to us.
Okay.
But didn't the guy say when we went out there for that visit that afternoon, didn't he say he was going to get in touch with, was it Libby from Hayes Engineering?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And wasn't she going to get back to you?
I haven't heard from Libby.
Okay.
Well, when you asked them to move the fence, they moved the fence, right?
I haven't been pushing them.
Yeah.
I was pushing them before, and like I said, what I think is happening is they're getting their shop set up.
Yep.
And
they're trying to make sure the kitchen works, and
you know, we have
work there. And
you know, we have. I mean, I don't think it's unusual for us. For my policy is to get certificates of compliance right away. But it's not unusual to not have one for several years or 10 or 20 years. So, and we'll get those coming in every once in a while. We've been pretty lucky with the way the process works around here. So,
okay.
We'll get on it this summer. I'm sure they're gonna do that. I'm sure that those bounds on the Cookies property are gonna be negotiated because it's something that they don't know about, so it's not gonna just happen. They don't own that property, and they put it on their property, but every time they try to work next to it, the abutting neighbors, whose last name is Cookie, have been objecting. So there's always a first or second step before the actual work can start.
Okay, you know what I forgot to talk about? First item on the old new business is 44 Roma Lane.
Well, he's standing outside waiting to talk. Who approved the extension and who's seconded?
I made a motion.
I think I did.
Yeah.
For Strawberry. I was talking about myself.
Yeah, for Strawberry. You think Al did?
Yeah, I'll
Well, you tell Al. We appreciate it.
Talking to my friend Al the other day.
All right, so let's we got this extension done, and then we have the annual report, and then we have Roma Lane. But we can do Roma Lane right now if you want.
Sure. What are we doing about Roma Lane?
We'll talk about discussing it.
Hey.
Good evening.
How are
you? Good, how are you?
So we closed the hearing. I'm just making you aware of that.
Right.
Oh, okay.
So we're kind of in a, what does that mean? That we don't take any input from, we can talk amongst ourselves, and that's probably how this should start. And then we'll see what happens.
Ability to reopen the meeting?
No.
No.
It's not golf.
Okay, no mulligans?
No.
So, what do we do?
So we have a motion to close the meeting, you asked me to prepare an order denying this project. Between the meetings.
Not the project, but the.
The INRAD.
The INRAD.
Hi, the INRAD. Between the meetings, I had, several conversations with, Mr. Carroll about, the commission paying for the wetland, third-party review on the wetland line. And, then I suggested that, we, you know, again, I suggested that we reduce the scope of the project, so, you know, we were only looking at a certain line. And then it got down to what, you know, if we came to a compromise, how much land, knowing that it's kind of a you know, we didn't approve any wetland line, so no one knows what's going on out there. I wanted to know what he was thinking about putting in there and how much land he wanted. Each time that we talked about this, and we did talk about it for a long time and really understood each other's points, there was no way that we could come to an agreement on where the line should be. Mr. Carroll's under the impression that he owns all the entire site, and for us to not for us to, you know, he feels like it's a taking, if anyone understands that term, if we're able to slap a wetland line on that property. So I will quickly get to his site and show you where he thought a good line would be. If I can get there quickly. Whoops, there you go.
Provide a little bit more context to the conversation.
You have to, again, we're really supposed to be talking amongst ourselves.
So,
at some point,
terrible,
you could chime in.
So,
it's because we closed the hearing.
So, Chuck, I mean, people have come before us just to discuss potential other projects or routes to go with that, not necessarily the current thing being, not necessarily the current application. I mean, we've closed and voted on the current thing. I don't, there is no way to open it, right?
Did they get that wrong? Okay. No, there's no way to open it.
No, you don't open
I'm
it.
Just telling you guys can do what you want. I just want to make sure I'm clear with the regulations and letting you know what is expected of you. If you want Mr. Carroll to talk, that's, you know what you're supposed to be doing, but you can do whatever you want.
That's my thought, is to save everybody a lot of aggravation. Let's just have a discussion and see if we can come to a compromise and resolve this issue. It's my thought.
Do you have a proposed compromise that you're bringing to the table tonight?
No,
okay.
I'm want to listen.
So I can
you meant among ourselves.
I think
no. Let's include Mr. Carroll. What he's proposing. I mean,
what I would like to see
is the same way we left off before we denied it. You know,
well,
we're obviously, as a board, we're not going to pay for
right.
to have his line delineated.
We did offer.
I think he said.
You offered to pay?
Yeah, we did, and he declined.
Why did you? I wasn't here for that.
I don't remember offering to pay.
That was a decision I think made by the chair.
Okay.
Based on the
and recommendations from the planner.
You see it yet?
And based on the funds that the town has
permitted. That's just ridiculous.
As a leverage tool to get this project to an acceptable completion. So we have before us a request to verify the wetland line and for us to sign off on that. And we have, Mr. Carroll's provided us with his consultant's line. And part of the file includes the line by Mr. Manuel, and other information includes our site visits that we've we went out to with Oxbow Associates.
November 17th.
Which I know, Mr. Panett, you were there for,
yeah.
I was there for.
I was there and Chuck was there.
It's Harry, I can't remember.
No, I haven't been to the site.
No.
So, Mr. Carroll's line does not cross his back property line. Sorry, the wetland line stays off, literally off his property. Mr. Manuel's line gets close to the back corner of his house on his property. So there are two very different wetland lines. And it's up to us to either
I think I have the other line.
Approve or deny Mr. Carroll's
proposed
line.
We already denied
it. That was denied at the last meeting?
Yeah.
Okay.
We denied it at the last meeting.
Denied what?
The INRAD.
No, we closed the hearing.
We closed the hearing and
we
told you to issue a
denial.
We
said prepare.
Prepare a denial.
A denial.
Mm-hmm.
No one made a motion.
Okay. All right.
So we're in the discussion portion.
Right.
All right, so let's hear from Mr. Carroll. Is there
well,
a proposal here, Mr.
Carroll?
Does everyone agree?
I'm not sure I do, because I think that what Chuck's coaching us on is the meeting's closed. It's closed for public comment, which means no one else gets to comment either from the community, right? And theoretical, right?
You know,
so,
I was being, you know, I was reading the regulations, right?
Well,
you know,
it's good to know what we're supposed to do. So.
Yeah,
there's
so,
never
okay.
been an abada here in opposition, has there? I don't know. Chuck?
No. I don't recall.
So can we just do it in order and just, Chuck, you were about to tell us what you and Mr. Carroll discussed. Can you just tell us what
the line
at?
I just drew up, that we have to imagine that everything where it's steep
yeah.
is not going to be wet.
Right.
Because it's just a hill.
Yeah.
So Mr. Carroll thought that thinks about this property and his future plans for this piece of property, and he doesn't have any plans that are in stone at this point. And here's what I think is the existing tree line. And he said where he'd like to be with his plans or his dreams for this area would be in this area of this of. All this on this side would be wet. I think I drew this line wrong. Now that I think about it, it needs to go up in this direction. But so from this line over would be considered non-jurisdictional.
What's non-jurisdictional?
Non-jurisdictional means we have no. The Conservation Commission is not under control of this property in this area. So
that's outside. That's typically what we call outside the 100-foot.
Yeah. Well, I'm just telling you
what
we've decided that he wants this called, non-jurisdictional. Now, I believe Mr. Carroll doesn't understand a lot of the terms, and when there's a resource area and the buffer zone, I believe that's all one area to Mr. Carroll. So, but anyways, what I'm getting is, this is the area where he wants to be able to put anything he wants there. So, that's what it is.
And the Oxbow line is all below the property line.
Yes, it's
the Oxbow line is exactly like the data layer from DEP. So,
if you move that image,
yeah,
up
I can
a
see
bit.
I can see the edge of the 35, right?
Yeah, this is the Oxbow line.
That's.
And the data layer of the DEP is pretty much the exact same thing.
Okay.
And when we were on the site visit, we had asked Oxbow Associates to auger some soil samples to the west of the property line or stone wall. It's an existing stone wall.
So we started right here at A10. And Oxbow
was in around here where we found some hydric soil. About 10 feet up is where I'm trying to go. And then we were up in here by the stone wall, and I think people who were there, just tell me if I'm wrong, we were by the stone wall the next time we augered, and it was hard
right,
to get that
rocks.
Auger in. And we moved it because of the rocks and the soil, that's what the in the roots. So we kept trying, this was Brian Butler, president of Oxbow, and then we got in the soil about there, and I think we all thought that that was hydric too. We crossed the stone wall pretty much in this area here, and then worked back in this direction.
There was a hydric soil.
8-inch oak tree, and it's right here. I think that's the one. So somewhere between this 8-inch, I gotta look over here, I can't really read that.
That's the 8-inch oak and the 20-inch oak, but we were up
above that. So we were here. And this is where their test pit was. I'm gonna have to make their new test pit on the supplemental material was kind of in this area here. Here's a, what's that oak tree?
Way up by the road, is that the 30-inch oak?
This is a 30-inch oak. This says 30-inch oak, and right above here, we found blueberry bush. And there was an auger, taken,
on the down, yeah, the downside.
Taken around here that Oxbow, when they pulled it out, I don't know if we discussed it, but it was certainly hydric to at least two of the commission members, and Oxbow was saying it was up. So from what I feel like, this is soils are gonna be hydric in a lot of these areas, and we have that 500 square foot wetland, you know, it needs to be at least
isolated
feet. Yeah, isolated wetland. So even if it's crossing off, you're going to probably get 500 feet in some configuration around here, soils. But we have oak tree, what was the other one?
Pignut hickory,
yeah. Oak, another oak. This all oak trees growing around here, and they all have buttress roots, and they're on either hummocks or clump of soil. But this is a very rocky site, which could explain the buttress roots. And and I think that's the conclusion of the people that were out there, that we have some movement here with the line. This wasn't official. We never said, hey, move that line. It was kind of with the people in the know, we knew what was going on. It was, you know, hydric soil. Let's move on to the next one, hydric soil. We didn't have our plan out or market for them to change it at the next meeting, because usually they submit another plan showing where the new line is, and they didn't do that with that supplement. So anyways, we talked about this, and we were sufficiently confused about the situation and said, because of the differences here and here, and the fact that we have high bush blueberry, which is an indicator of a wet area, we felt that we had enough confusion going on to ask for a third party review. Plus it's a rocky site on hummocks, and that not everyone can figure out that type of site, because you got to get through the rocks, you got to find a spot, very gravelly soil, tough to really read.
Okay.
So that kind of brought us to where we're at, and then when we asked for the third party review, Mr. Carroll declined and said, please close the hearing. And then that's when the negotiation started. I was offered, asked to offer him the town would pay for.
Who asked you that?
Julie Messier, who is my direct person in charge.
What, you've been here 6 years?
What's
seven,
that?
How, 6 or 7 years?
What are we talking about?
Have you been here 6 or 7 years?
Yeah.
Have we ever paid in the past since you've been here?
You know, we're not here to, I mean, the town's not here to make money, and the town is not here to cause grief unnecessarily. And that is a reasonable request to find out if we could solve this situation. And with simple review, plus, you know, we have a little bit of money this year, we don't have a lot. I mean, it is unfortunate that we would have to spend it, but that is a reasonable request, because we're in the business of finding out the answer to these things, and we have every right to do that.
I don't agree with that.
Well, I respect that.
In any way, shape, or form, we're not in the business of delineating people's property for them. This doesn't appear to be a hardship. I completely disagree.
Respectfully, Al, we have delineated small residential parcels.
Yeah, Chuck has.
Right.
We didn't pay
for
that's it.
Right. Well, yes, actually, you do pay for that. That's.
Well, I'd be willing to do that. I'd be willing to let Chuck delineate this line if he's willing to abide by it.
See, the problem is I can't delineate
this
line because it's a controversial site, and Matt would never accept my delineation, and that's obvious from the start.
Well, listen, I'm only one vote, but
you're right.
I am not going to vote to pay to delineate this line.
That's right.
Well,
so
Mr.
it wasn't
Mr.
accepted anyways, so
Mr.
we don't
Carroll
really need to go
anyways.
down that road. But there was, you know, there's 5 other votes on this board that haven't voiced their opinion yet. So that was one of the offers. And then the next one was to, you know, let's try to figure out what we're doing. So I did talk to Julie about how much land is available in this area to work on, say for a pool, because a pool and a deck was submitted back on the original 2013 plan, and it was basically they could do that. So if that was the project, that could have been done under the town regulations, not that it went through conservation. So at least that hurdle was, we got over that hurdle.
Can you explain that to the members a little bit more? What line was used? Was that the previous?
No line, just setbacks, just planning board setbacks.
Yeah, planning, so we started with the planning board setbacks, and then we used the manual 2013 plan, and then put on top of that an 8.5 by 11 copy of a pool and patio, which fit nicely, you know, in the backyard and on the side. But it doesn't make any sense to talk about. I did that before I talked to Matt. We had several conversations. So, you know, I had this information. I wanted to find out if it was even allowable by the town, because the town sometimes restricts pools and structures if they're not in the setbacks and whatnot. But this one did fit. So we're back to knowing that project that he at least was considering back in 2013 was a viable project for this land outside of what conservation needs to approve. But that was the manual plan. Does everyone remember the manual plan, or does it make sense?
I don't know where the manual line is.
The oxbow line is below the stone wall, and it doesn't creep into Mr. Carroll's property. The manual line comes way up. I could draw it, or I could show you it. I don't know which one
show
is.
It.
Yeah.
Where was the proposed pool going? Was that going behind the house?
That's the manual.
Well, it was kind of on the side of the house. It was trying to use what they could and still get what they want. It was a compromise.
That line show on the house in the 35?
Hmm.
Yeah.
Based
yeah.
on the manual line.
Can you zoom in, please?
That's the line.
So I'm afraid to ask, was there a line drawn when the house was built? Is the house built at, what, how old is the house?
I don't know when the house, when was the house built? You can.
'92.
'92.
I'm the second owner.
You're the second. So someone else drew a third line that we don't know about that actually allowed the house to be built.
That in the, did you check the files, Chuck, on it? Is there a file on that?
You know what, I have to say that until that was said, I never thought to look back at those files. I mean, we're really dealing with.
Well, regardless, we have a line that the applicant has paid to be delineated behind his house. There's the bill manual line that I move we accept as part of the record. And we just have to decide whether we're going to approve or deny the ORAD. Do we agree with this line or not?
So hold on before you vote. So if we, if excellent. Let's say that there's a plan out there that allowed this house to be built, it doesn't mean that they even checked this area. But it is interesting. I mean, you know, it's interesting to find out. I mean, nothing was built there, so it seems to me that this possibly.
There's probably a third line somewhere in between the two. I guess, you know, yeah. You know how I look at it, honestly? It's hard because it's an ANRAD. If we had an NOI that said, okay, we got two variations of the line and they compete, but Mr. Carroll wants to put in a pool in his and a deck in for the kids, and we're not going to put in road and six houses back there. He owns the property. We're really not sure where the line should be. And so almost approving a variance, and I know we don't usually do that, but finding a way to make something happen rather than pay another consultant to tell us what we already know, which is that, you know, I mean, any consultant's going to tell us the same thing. It's sort of gray, and it could be here, it could be there. It's going to be a hard one for anybody to do. But because it's an ANRAD, we're not really allowed to think about what's going to be built there. So if we approve the ANRAD, we see a two-story concrete bunker go up. We're not really in a position to object to that. So that's my personal feeling of why this is a little bit harder than it otherwise might be.
I completely agree.
I feel like we should be able to find a way to let the guy build a pool in his yard when we've got enough debate that we can't really tell where the wetland is.
Well, I disagree. I think it's very simple. I think the only matter before us tonight is, do we agree that the wetland line he proposed is something we can accept as a wetland resource line? That's all we have.
We
don't have any proposed plans. We know he's interested in more activities behind his house. However, we can't make a determination based on speculation.
Right.
We have no data, and in my opinion, I'm convinced that we don't have sufficient data to approve the line or lines proposed. And I think it's that simple.
Well, I think I agree with you. I think that's what we said 2 weeks ago. That's why we voted to issue a decline.
So I'm
just trying to apply some common sense to it.
I would
try to think of a way to.
I think Harry's right, but I think the non-cooperation, if the applicant would agree to giving us enough information to delineate a line, and that line needed to have a variance here and there to accommodate on a single family home, a pool, or work you wanted to do in his yard, I think we'd all be sympathetic to that and would probably do that. For me, the hurdle is I don't think we should be just saying, well, you know, the applicant's being stubborn, so we don't really know where it is, so let's just say it's back there.
But Mr.
There.
Couillard, we've offered third party. We've also offered to pay for a delineation.
I
so
know.
Attempts have been made to
I had no
meet
idea
the requirements
at the last meeting
that
we had offered the applicant to pay for a delineation at a prior meeting.
I understand, but
that would have
at But with that information,
Not at a prior meeting.
This
it wasn't at the meeting I was at.
This happened
no,
between
it wasn't,
last
no,
this happened between last meeting and this meeting.
Oh, this just happened.
You guys would have to have approved it.
Yeah, and I agree with Al. I don't think we should be paying for somebody to delineate.
But you know, I'm in the position where I have to do what I'm told.
It was floated
I
as a possibility.
It. I get it.
So it's not
it
that it's not that we are not being accommodating. And in this situation, I mean, we have to come up with a justifiable exception or rejection of this order.
In this situation, I think we have to take a hard line, even though most of us don't want to do that.
Well, I don't
feel
think
like
we
I'm
are.
Being forced into that. Well, we've already closed the meeting and deny that ANRAD and send him to an appeal.
You don't have to accept any line.
We don't have to. We can reject the ANRAD for insufficient information.
And I think
which
that's where we have been
appeal.
Staying.
I think part of the discussion
that could
here
be.
Sends him to the state.
It could be.
It could be. That's
it's
up
not
to
could
the
be.
Applicant.
It's, well, I mean, if that's if he wants
it's
to move
to
forward,
applicant.
That's his next step.
I think
that's
I think,
a hard line as far
you
as I'm
know what,
concerned.
Boy, but if
but
it were
I
my
Al,
property.
There's another option. It can get withdrawn. A new plan can get put together with an actual structure, with actual plan, and where they think the line is, and we can evaluate based on what actually plans to go in. That's not what's here today. I think we've all said that we would be open to looking at that with a different set of eyes versus an ANRAD, the current ANRAD that's being proposed. But that's not what's in front of us today. There are ways to go from here. We don't know what route the applicant would take. I think that still stands. I think the commission has said where we would go if one direction would be taken, but it still stands that this ANRAD, I think we all have a consensus of where the line, what this current application is, where this current application's at. So.
I agree.
I guess my take is still the same with this application. I'm not improving that this line.
The Oxbow line.
Correct.
Right. Okay.
So does that mean as we brought this forth and rediscussed it, that we're going to keep with the denial of the ANRAD?
Well, this is what we're going to discuss.
Talking about.
I would.
What's your opinion?
I would stick with the denial because I don't think there's. And when I walk the site, I'm going to be honest with you. I don't actually agree with both of them for some reasons, and I know that there was. I think Bill's line that's there, I think, is too far over the. I can't really see where the stone wall is there. Is that the heavy line that's at the top of that?
It's a straight. Yeah, the straight line. It's like a little dotted.
I can't really see where his line goes beyond the stone wall. It appears that it goes at kind of a rather acute angle.
He's up. Closer to the stone wall than the Oxbow line.
Oh, he is? Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I didn't see that. Never mind. So, actually, I agree with where he's near the stone wall. I'm in
so he's,
much
he's
further
closer
agreement with
all
Bill
the way
Manuel's
around.
Line as it crosses in parallels the stone wall than the Oxbow line. For many reasons. And even the line that comes across, I'm not really, I can't tell the difference, but that line that actually comes somewhat parallel to the stone wall that kind of cuts across there at A12, from A12 to A11.
Mm-hmm.
We noticed, and Anika and I, when we were in there, noticed some indications that were in there as well. It was closer to the stone wall, but
you felt the soil was spongy.
Chuck,
yes.
In there? Is that
yeah? Very much so.
I don't know the answer to this. Maybe Mike or Anika wanted to do. So we deny this. We close the meeting. We deny this tonight for insufficient information. How long before an applicant could resubmit a different plan? Is it 3 years? I have 3 years in my head. But
no.
Well, if
right?
we don't approve a line.
So if we don't approve the line and we deny it, he could come back
anytime.
Tomorrow.
Month
yes.
With a plan, with a different line and a pool and a deck and what he wants to do on it.
Yeah, he could, yes.
And then we could evaluate that line.
Right.
Evaluate
it's
that.
A whole new permit.
Right.
Well, then, I think my opinion is to deny it for insufficient information.
Okay, do I hear a motion?
Do we wanna?
Just a reminder, there's a motion to accept Bill Manuel's plan as part of the record.
I think we should be saying this, but do you wanna have Matt give him an opportunity at this point? Maybe if there's something he wants to jump on?
Can I first ask for?
I mean, I have to tell you, you're not supposed to do this, but go ahead.
I think we did.
Can I first request a vote to accept the Manuel plan as part of the record?
We did it at the last meeting, I think. Didn't we, Chuck? Accept that plan?
We have a motion to accept the Manuel meeting.
There's a second?
I'll second.
Okay.
All right, all those in favor?
What?
Wait, what?
No.
Opposed?
What are you doing? You just accepted the Manuel plan?
As part of the record.
Thank you.
Are you opposed?
Wait a minute, guys.
Are you in favor of?
No, he's opposed.
The plan or opposed?
He's opposed.
I'll accept it.
They're all part of the record. The Manuel plan.
As soon as you talk about it, it's part of the record.
The plan that's been submitted to us is a revision of the Manuel plan. So all the plans.
It's just a procedural motion, so it's already been voted in.
And I think we did that at the last meeting too.
Just in case.
Yeah, we did it at the last meeting for the same reason. So I make a motion to deny the request for the ANRET.
Do I hear a second?
I'll second.
All those in favor?
Hold on.
Okay.
Are you gonna get some input?
All right, Mr. Carroll, before we vote.
How can I help?
Well, you heard what they're looking for. They're looking, so if I could translate this, I would say, first, do you know of any compromises sitting here tonight, hearing what the commission has said? Second, they are forced to make a decision tonight on this, but they're saying, I heard one commission say that they would not deny you a pool, patio, or something, but they feel like their hands are tied because they don't know what's going to go on there. So in a sense, they're saying, you know, you could come right back with another plan that shows something, and I hear that they're willing to work with you. I'm only talking to him. You know, you can correct this when he comes in, all right?
Yeah, no, I just think that discussion can occur whether or not this vote takes, you know, after this vote takes place.
Right, but his input can't. So
why
maybe
can it? After the fact? I mean, there's no input that's allowed on this application at this point any longer. He can provide his input on any future thoughts of another application at any time.
That's what he says. So if he says tonight, okay, I changed my mind, I'll pay the $50.
I guess it was
bucks,
my effort in making him part of the process.
I know, but hear me out.
You know,
if he said tonight, okay, I changed my mind, I'll go to peer review, I'll pay the $1,500 and we'll live with that line, we can't do that. We can't do that tonight.
We'd only close the hearing. You can do a discussion amongst yourself. You didn't make a decision. You have all your options. You're just not taking any input.
Are you willing to do that?
Well,
go ahead. You can answer.
So when Chuck had called me, I think it was Thursday or Friday last week, and I've talked to him several times this week. He asked me if I could come up with an area within my side yard that would be sufficient and acceptable to me, and be able to work on my behalf, and so I provided that to Chuck. He did present the option of having the town pay for the third party to have the line delineated, and it was presented at the last meeting as an option that I declined as well. So that, at least for me as an option, is off the table right now, but I did provide that area that Chuck outlined in there, at least as a starting point to, I guess, present to you folks of an idea of the workable area that I was looking to work in. As far as what's set in stone of my intents, yes, we've had aspirations of possibly putting in a pool, obviously having that encompasses that, which would be, you know, deck and patio and hard surfaces.
Or it could very well just be a lawned area and an extension of our current backyard, which are two completely different things. And the manual line that included the pool proposal back in 13 that's been entered into this, I never presented that to the board. It was discussed, but I never brought before the board. It was entered, the line was entered this past time, this fall, in an effort just to be transparent, because everybody knew that it was out there, so why try to hide it? But I never filed it to be on my original application back in 2012 and 13. So that's kind of where I'm at right now. Definitely not looking to put an in-law apartment on the side of the house. Definitely not looking to pave it over. Certainly understand your concerns with leaving it wide open like that, but that's kind of where myself and my family are right now. We're kind of in between those proposed ideas, and certainly budgetary concerns with our family will play a big impact of whether or not we do that. But that kind of area off the side of the yard is the general area that we're looking to. Certainly, that's my wish, and it was brought to from Chuck that maybe a compromise could be made, and I'm certainly willing to explore another possibility if another line similar to that would be acceptable to the commission.
Would you be looking to put the pool and the decking around it at somewhere near the existing grade, or are you looking to build a wall and build that up so it's more in keeping with your backyard grade?
Well, I think that would play into the fact of the financials of looking into the project. Certainly, that could save some costs in building on the existing grade level and bringing in material to bring that level up. Certainly, any sort of retention wall in that area for whatever purpose. My intent was to use rocks and boulders rather than using any sort of retaining wall or brick and mortar structure, which would essentially tie in with the property line across the back, which is essentially delineated by that existing natural rock wall. So.
Okay.
So thank you very much for
thank you,
crashing the meeting. Chuck invited me, I don't know if he told you, so.
So, in my opinion, the area, as far as I can tell so far, the best area that I would suggest, and this is, I'm just only one member clearly, to put some sort of backyard structure would be on the existing lawn. And because if that area that's shown on the plan right now as wetland, if that area is, it's still very much up in the air, how much of that is exactly wetland resource area? And it's illegal to fill wetlands in the state of Massachusetts. It includes grass, shrub, tree clippings, and soil. So if that area, that delineated by the manual line is confirmed by a professional in a sufficient manner to be jurisdictional wetlands in the town of Massachusetts, and as Chuck described, it could be 500 square feet isolated wetlands, it could be continuous with the rest of the wetlands beyond the stone wall. We don't know. I don't have enough information to make that decision. That's why I'm going to vote tonight to deny the ANRAD. It's just a lack of information. So at this point, there is enough information to suspect it might be a good amount of that might be wetland. So at this point, if I were to propose some additional work, I would strongly encourage you to stay out of the 25-foot line, or if you even can, out of the 35-foot line. But, so if you're thinking about what to do after this, That would be my suggestion.
Well, the 35-foot line on this manual drawing goes into
your house.
The existing house itself.
Oh, I understand. I understand. I'm just, you know, but in terms of filling, adding additional grade or doing additional leveling over to the left, I would prefer that not be done. That said, we have had projects that have, where residents have taken wetlands, but when they take, they have to provide replacement contiguous with the taking
mm-hmm.
at a 2-to-1 ratio.
Mm-hmm. And Chuck explained that to me.
So design wise, moving forward, there's that to consider.
If I was to come back to the commission with an NOI, is that right?
Notice of intent, yeah.
Notice of intent.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I would be using the Oxbow line that delineated the wetlands on that line. How would that be regarded at that point?
That would be treated the same way as this application
okay.
was. It would be rejected for insufficient information.
Gotcha.
So there's almost no point in
using that line.
That's
if,
correct.
If I wanted to come back with
it. I'm not saying that all that line is incorrect,
yeah.
and I'm not saying that all of the manual line is correct.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm of the opinion Dave shared, which is
that
the truth of the situation might be somewhere between those two, but we don't have enough information to say exactly what that line is.
Sure.
And once that line is nailed down, then the setbacks are... Then we have a line to go on, and you have a line to design to
mm-hmm.
and design from.
Okay.
Is that clear? Do you have any?
Very clear. I guess my presence in the meeting tonight, I thought there was a possibility of some collaboration to come up with a compromise of a work area. And I respect the fact that you folks can't come to...
I think we've talked about this a lot. And I thought we made our case pretty clear for several meetings that we've had with this, is that it is so difficult to make a decision
mm-hmm.
with, you know, just standing out there for a couple hours with Oxbow consultants. You know, some of the area was hydric, some of it wasn't. There was wetland vegetation, in other areas there were upland vegetation. And so I think this area deserved a little bit more scrutiny. And I don't believe that it got that. And so there was insufficient information, and that's my
Understood.
Feeling about it.
Understood.
And in order to, I mean, that's exactly what the permit was requesting.
Yes.
Was, is the resource area delineated correctly, and would we put into law that is
mm-hmm.
a legal line?
Understood.
So
there's a motion. Chuck prepared an ORAD.
No, denial.
A denial, sorry. Denial of, thank you.
The ANRAD.
Of the ANRAD.
Do I hear a second?
I already seconded.
Okay. All those in favor? Thank you, Mr. Carroll.
Thank you very much. Sorry for keeping everybody late.
No, this is
thank
actually
you.
Fairly early.
Good. Well, enjoy the rest of the week.
Good
thank
luck
you.
Going forward.
Thanks,
Chuck.
Yeah.
See you later, Matt.
Do we have something to sign for that?
Yes.
Or
yeah, this is, what is the, so I sent this out to everyone. I assume no one got a chance to look at it.
No, I did.
You did.
We talked
and
about.
And I made those modifications, but I think you have that copy.
Oh, I am
but
right.
We can sign this and accept that with the there's no amendments, it's been presented as is, but we can make amendments on it if we want.
I want to amend it to say that we never talk about Roma Lane again.
What's that?
I want to make an amendment that we never talk about Roma Lane again.
I know, huh?
Can I make
I mean,
a request?
It seems crazy. It seems solvable. I know everyone's frustrated, but it seems solvable, but I don't think you want to.
It seems like anything except if Well, the lines are too far apart, and he bought into the Oxbow line.
Any member of this board wants somebody to build a pool near a wetlands, it's me. But you gotta, I mean, we can't operate like that. I mean, it's just, right, it's crazy. I actually feel bad, but he wasn't helping.
Well, there are a number of options, alternatives.
Yeah.
Because he's free to accept or reject them. It was his purview just to do that.
If it were me, I would have paid for it.
For the record, though?
No way.
I agree with Al. I think that...
No way.
We shouldn't set... That's precedent. I really don't want to set. And I just think that... I mean, I get the rationale for why we would do it, but
I never heard of such a thing. 30 years, I've never heard of
it. It's in the email from the chair of MACC saying that is an option.
That's okay.
So you've never heard of it before.
Send an email back and ask her to pay for it.
You just haven't got out much.
I
think you're objecting to it based on principles, some definition of what you think, but again, I was trying to set it up. We're supposed to solve a problem. The money's there to do that.
But I think part two of my comment was, once that third line is drawn, and we know it's probably going to be somewhere between the two, it's still not going to work for him.
Well, he might have to fill and replicate. He'll have to come up with a plan. It's up to him.
Yeah.
It's out of our hands.
I mean, we're not supposed to solve problems.
We're supposed to try and find.
I don't know.
We're supposed to try and find a happy medium. That doesn't mean pay for stuff and design the guy's pool and yacht.
Right here. And you look at the 35-foot line that's behind the house. You know, you could build a kidney-shaped pool that's in there, that's inside the setback and side setback.
A good size pool is 20 by 30, right? With a 3-foot apron. You could put that right there in the upland if you went with that.
Right.
You may have a point, though, that there's some... Kylie Drive, there was an issue on the pool next to the house.
Right.
It was
pool,
something
yeah,
to
you're
do
right.
with
the pool can't be too close to the house. Like that,
right. So I don't know.
The fire department needs to be able to lean a ladder against your house.
Yeah, that's far enough back.
Tell that to the 10 million people in L.A. with a pool. In their house,
and
in Florida, everywhere else I live.
Okay.
You live in
what
LA
else
too?
We got? Administrator's
report.
Went
to school there
annual
for 4 years,
report.
So I was there a lot.
Well, I've been busy on 44 Roma Lane.
All right. Is there anything left? A report?
Emergency permit, none. Bills, none. Minutes?
They're good.
None.
I looked at them. They're great.
Chuck, seriously, how long do I have for the annual report?
You need to get that to me you need to just send it out to everyone as soon as you can. That's supposed to be in by the 1st.
Okay, all right.
So, are you guys familiar with the annual report and what it's about and what we add to it? Anybody interested?
I'll read it when it comes out.
It's just
state of conservation.
Yeah.
It's a summary.
Synopsis of what happened over the year.
I was here. I don't need a report. I remember.
You remember it all, right, Al?
What'd you write about last year, Al?
Huh?
What'd you write about last year?
Yeah, I'm going to submit the same report this year as I did last year.
Yeah, thanks.
All right.
Can I make a motion to adjourn?
Can I just add one other item, just briefly?
No.
Quick. Chuck, do you make it a comment to applicants that we will not consider information that's sent 2 hours or the same day as a meeting?
Who you and specifically who are you talking about?
Well, today's example was
no. I will never tell the town that we cannot get them on the agenda.
Okay.
I agree. I think there's always times that somebody can come before us and it takes time to explain it, and we have always have the right to say no.
And we have the right to bump it forward.
But
yeah.
I think we should always listen.
But that dewatering, that was a big one to get last. That was a big technical one to get last minute.
I know you were talking about it, but it seemed to me that it came down to everything's allowed no matter what. It's already been thought about as long as they're providing, you know, the information. Even the soil's being taken off the site, that could be a question mark. And no matter whatever happens, the water can always be infiltrated. So I really didn't see why we even needed to discuss it this much.
It was a little suspicious to me that everything Ryan said, the three amigos behind him went like that.
Because they probably talked over it a lot. I'll tell you.
I'm sitting, I'm like,
I was looking for the teleprompter.
I first heard about this 2 days ago, and I contacted Mike about it. And they were supposed to put it together. Now, it seemed an unusually long time. And this isn't Ryan. You know, Ryan is very thorough, and I think they put a lot into it. I mean, he basically had the answer to every question. So
he had every legal interpretation. But
exactly.
I gotta tell you, you know, the thing that was hard for me, because I'm not an engineer, is I didn't know what the heck they were talking about. Like, how big of a hole are they digging? I mean, 300 yards of soil to me sounds like something as big as a house.
Yeah.
Well, like I said, just look at Mike when he starts. I mean.
Well, I mean, so that was Ryan's problem.
Got some experience in it.
Well, right,
that was Ryan's problem. Ryan didn't.
He talked engineer at a banker, and I just didn't.
He dove right into it and didn't give any background.
I tried to ask for context, and I just didn't feel like I knew where we were starting.
And I read the information, and it still was when he started in. It's like,
I don't even know what goes in the hole. I mean, I don't know what a pumping station looks like.
So pumping station.
You know, and I got the plans on my phone 2 hours before the meeting while I was sitting on a train. Hey, you ready to go?
Just one more thing.
This don't seem to be minutes worthy, what we've just been talking about.
Oh, please add every word of that stuff.
I just
talk about the font you're going to use.
I'll second your motion.
All those in favor.
Sold!
Done.